Israel Folau. The latest since yesterday is that he's notified Rugby Australia that he intends to contest this high-level code of conduct breach notice. Rugby Australia say they want that to take place as soon as possible. Whatever happens out of that, it does seem from all the comments that have been coming from Michael Cheka from Rugby Australia that Israel Folau's career with the Wallabies is over.
You'd have to imagine so. It'd be a long way back for Australian rugby, or Rugby Australia, whatever they refer to themselves as. They were adamant in their statements that it was unacceptable behaviour, which it was. He'd been warned, he'd had it written into his newly signed contract that there was going to be no similar references, as we saw almost a year ago. So I don't see how there's any way back, but this one will play out.
Yeah, the legality of what Israel Folau said isn't straightforward, as much as the comments are pretty abhorrent to most of us. They are his genuinely held religious beliefs, and Rugby Australia chief Rylene Castle said, "This is not a religious discussion. This is a discussion around the employee-employer relationship and the values and contractual arrangements within that agreement. That's the basis on which we've served him a breach of notice." And the key point there is that he just signed a new contract worth a huge amount of money within the last few months. And as Rugby Australia have briefed, minutes were kept of the contractual negotiations where this was outlined to Israel Folau again and again and again, that he cannot make these type of comments on social media.
Of course they're keeping it legal because it's that on legal grounds that the contract has been torn up. Irrespective of what your opinion is, I don't know the legalities of it, but you would imagine in any employer contract or employment contract that if you rugby, be it in the business world, be it as an accountant, it doesn't matter, that if you make references to homosexuals in a negative connotation, it has to be grounds for disruptive behaviour and certainly to be called into question as to whether employment should remain. The fact that this happened a second time, having had all of that discussion and, as we said, a new contract drawn up, for me, it's a closed case.
Yeah, so the legality of what's right and what's wrong may not be straightforward, but the way people respond can be actually quite straightforward. And Michael Cheka was out quickly, which may have actually made things slightly more difficult from a legal point of view, but he came out very quickly saying he wouldn't be selecting Israel Folau. When you play in the gold jersey, we represent everyone in Australia, everyone. Everyone that's out there supporting us, we don't pick and choose. Saying that, quite simply, that's just the right thing to do for Michael Cheka.
It is, but Michael Cheka is a man of principle as well. You look at his origin. He comes from a Lebanese background, so he's certainly one of those multitude of diverse cultures that have immersed themselves or found themselves in Australia. And I think there's been a big onus within Australia and within this Wallabies team to embrace those different cultures, about explaining their backstory. You look at Will Guinea from Papua New Guinea, you look at how many Fijian boys have come across. So they're, not many of them would say they're purely Australian. A lot of them would say they ancestrally come from elsewhere, and they do. And so, but yet they unite as Wallabies and as Australians. So it doesn't surprise me that Chex has come out strong that way, because big leadership is very, very important to times like this. And it's a difficult one for him because it's his best player. He doesn't want to lose his best player for a Rugby World Cup. But you've got to stand on high ground and really important issues.
And part of the difficulty is what you touched on there, that so many of these Australian players come from different backgrounds, and several would share religious beliefs with Israel Folau, would not make these type of comments, certainly not publicly. Is there a potential issue for Michael Cheka within the dressing room now?
Yeah, of course, I'm sure there is. But was there not an issue beforehand with Israel Folau and David Pocock having such opposing issues on the same matter? So, I watched closely after the comments last year when Israel Folau, the next game they played, and Israel Folau scored a try, and David Pocock came up and embraced him, and it all seemed to be okay. But they clearly hold very different views. So I don't know. Again, similarly to how this case between Rugby Australia and Folau is going to play out, I suppose we won't know until the next time the Wallabies get together, or you won't hear until maybe months afterwards whether there was a divided dressing room on the back of this decision.
you mentioned he's comfortably their most important player. How big a blow is this, just in purely rugby terms, for Michael Checker for Australia, 6 months out from a World Cup?
Yeah, it's a huge blow. You know, he's a game breaker, and he's shown it time and time again that he can do some magical stuff. A guy that's able to play three codes says it all. You know, the fact that he excelled at rugby league, was, you know, very proficient AFL player, and then seamlessly jumped across and started playing rugby union, and was a real standout performer on the world stage. So you want, and Australia are in a position at the moment that they need their best players. They're going through a real lull by their standards. But yet, you look at what Michael Checa managed to do in an 18-month period back in 2014 into 2015, getting them to a World Cup final. You know, I know the person that he is. He'll see this as a challenge, and he'll take it head on, and he'll almost relish it. If he does lose his best player, it'll be another obstacle to hurdle to get to the pinnacle or to the summit.
Of course, it's moved on to the Northern Hemisphere as well, this controversy, because Billy Vunipola weighed in. He wrote that there just comes a point when you insult what I grew up believing in, that you just say enough is enough. Man was made for woman to procreate. That was the goal. No. So he made those comments. Saracens aren't going to suspend him. They've warned him about his behaviour, saying he made a serious error of judgement. He is going to play, it seems, against Munster this weekend. This was, I guess, in a way, the first time Billy Vunipola had made comments like this publicly. Was it the right reaction from Saracens?
Yeah, I think it was. I think they had to take a hard stand, and the RFU are allegedly going to have a hearing as well. You know, it's a fine line between free speech and having your comments as being perceived as dangerous, and that's what they are, to be honest with you. If you are segregating one group of individuals, and some might, you know, people will know, very vulnerable young kids that aren't sure about their sexuality, and that's what we're talking about ultimately. Whatever about liars and adulterers and everything else, I think it's the homosexual aspect is the issue. And you think about the dangerousness of those comments within a sporting context. There simply aren't compared to society, there are not the same category of gay sports people as there are in society. That is the reality, because they're afraid to come out. And these sort of comments are certainly not going to help young kids questioning their sexuality or uncertain of their sexuality and wanting to have that freedom to come out into a society that will accept them. When you have big name internationals like this, like Israel Folau, like Billy Vunipola, talking negatively about it, it's only going to make their situation exacerbate itself and create more stress for those individuals. So I think we can't condone that in any shape or form, and as a result I think Rugby Australia have responded well. Sarri's seen a slap on the wrist, but
is that enough then? Because obviously when it comes to sport and high level sport, the lines get blurred very easily when it comes to ethics and morals. That Billy Vunipola is a player of such stature, of such influence, that when he makes comments like that unfortunately, because you're such an influential person, that actually maybe the punishment needs to be harsher than if somebody else does.
They are awful. They're awful comments too, as far as I'm concerned. And some people will agree with me and some people will disagree. It doesn't match up with the values of the game of rugby. We're an inclusive game. It's a game for everyone. And when I talk about a game for everyone, it's the smallest individual to the largest individual and everybody in between. And every creed, every religion, it doesn't matter your sexuality. This is a game for everyone, and they're values that we've preached for a long time. And when someone counters that, I think they bring into question the morals of what our game is, and they question us. And as a result, I think there has to be a strong stand against those individuals and those players. And you know, I think Billy Vunipola is very, very lucky just to get a slap on the wrist.
And that dressing room culture, and have you ever found yourself in a situation where you've been embarrassed by antics of teammates, by things teammates have said that you felt it reflects on us as a group as a whole? Because that in many ways is unfair to look at Saracens as an organisation. Billy Vunipola is more than able to hold his own and should be held accountable for these comments. But it does end up reflecting on the greater group.
Yeah, it does. I think it sometimes takes the braver person in a dressing room when they don't like something that's been said to call someone out on it. I think it's less acceptable these days than even 5 years ago when I played, where, you know, you might have remained silent where you heard a derogatory comment of some sort. I think it would be less acceptable these days, or you would, you know, you would see less silence. People would challenge one another, and you, it's the environment and the way the world has gone that, you know, we're a way more open environment, and finally we're going in the right direction, as far as I'm concerned, towards accepting, you know, people of all kinds.